Okay, now we'll do more interesting stuff, and especially we will see how PyTorch is dealing with automatic differentiation. So we saw what tensors are, basically an equivalent of NumPy on GPU. And you will see that they are a little bit more than NumPy indeed. So here is one example in order to illustrate how PyTorch is dealing with automatic differentiation. So I'm considering this perhaps weird function, but you will see in the practicals why I'm using it. This is what you will need to code for the practical of this lesson. So think of W and B as real parameters of your function, X as the input, and Y star as the observation, the true value. So the exponent of W times X plus B is your prediction for the output Y, and L is the kind of loss you want to minimize. So this is the square of the difference between your estimation and the true value Y star. Now, in most cases in deep neural network, we will use an algorithm where you update the weight W and B by first computing the derivative of the loss with respect to this parameter W and B. So here, what we will do is try to compute automatically the derivative of the loss with respect to W and the partial derivative of the loss with respect to B. Okay. So here is what is called the forward pass in a deep neural network. So I'm basically breaking this complex operation in very simple operation. The first one here is just the multiplication of the input x with the weight, the parameter w. This gives me u. This second circle is just the addition of the bias. This gives me v. Then I'm taking the exponent of v. This gives me y. And then I'm computing the loss. So we'll see in a moment why it's important to break this complex operation into very simple steps. So let's start with. Okay, I modify my code a little bit. So you should have something like that in your notebook instead of mine. So let's start with a model with NumPy weight. Okay, so W will be 0.5, B is equal to 2, and the input X is 0.5. The first thing I'm doing is I'm transforming everything into tensors. Okay, so using the torch from NumPy operation we saw just before. So I'm putting an underscore T to say that now these are tensors. Now I need to tell PyTorch that I want to compute the derivative of this complex function with respect to these parameters. In order to do that, there is a Boolean field in each tensor which is requires grad, which tells exactly PyTorch what are the partial derivative it will need to compute for me. So by default, as you can see, this quantity is false. So when I'm creating a new tensor like here, this requires grad field for the tensor is set to false. So the first thing I want to do is setting to true. Okay. So now I did not modify the value of my tensor. It's still 0.5. But now PyTorch knows that whatever I'm doing with this parameter, I want to be able to compute the derivative with respect to it. I want to do the same thing for B. And you see that here I obtain an error. So why is that? And this is again to show you the impact, the possible impact of types in PyTorch. So here the error is only tensor of floating point D type can require guidance. So what happened here? B is an array with an integer inside. So when you created the tensor from here, from it, it automatically took the type of an int. But clearly, taking derivative with respect to integer doesn't make much sense. So PyTorch is expecting to receive each time a float tensor in order to be able to do automatic differentiation. So if you, the first thing you need to do here is to cast BT to a new type. Say to PyTorch, okay, BT is indeed not an integer. It's a floating, it's a real number which value is exactly 2. Okay, so this is what I'm doing here. I'm changing here the type of BT without modifying at all the value of B. And you see that now I did not modify the value of my bias, but there is, it's a 2 dot something, so it's 2.00000, and it's a floating number. And now I can take derivative with respect to that. Okay, so now I did define my tensor for the input, for the weight, and for the bias. And I did tell PyTorch that I want to take derivative with respect to the weight and the bias. So here is a definition of my function. Okay. So I'm taking my tensor version of the weight, tensor version of the bias. I'm multiplying the weight by my input x, adding the bias, taking the exponent, so torch.exp, which is the exponent for PyTorch. And then I'm taking the sum of the square, the difference of the square with the y star, which is the true value. Now I'm computing some random y star here, because this is just an example. So random numbers with the same shape as xt. And lt is now the loss associated to the input x and to the true value y star. Okay. So this is 99 something. And you see that the required grad Boolean field of LT is also set to true, because PyTorch will propagate this Boolean field to all the tensors which are computed with WT and BT. Okay, so now where is the gradient stored? It's stored in the grad field of the tensor. So if you ask what is the current gradient of WT, you see that right now you didn't compute any gradient, so this is just none, so it's empty. In order to compute the gradient, you apply the method backward. All the gradients will be computed automatically, and now you have the value of the gradient which appears here. Okay, let's see if we can interpret these numbers. So remember, we want to compute this quantity here, the derivative of the loss with respect to W, let's say. But W does not appear here. So what we will do is we will apply what is called the chain rule in mathematics. We will take the derivative of L with respect to its input Y, and then multiply it with the partial derivative of Y with respect to W. But as you see, the same thing is true for Y. W does not appear in this function. So again, what we will do is, in order to compute the partial derivative of y with respect to w, we will apply again the chain rule several times and take the partial derivative of y with respect to v, then multiply it by the partial derivative of v with respect to u, and then multiply it by the partial derivative of u with respect to w. And the chain rule tells you that if you are taking this product, this is exactly the partial derivative of y with respect to w. So in the end, if you plug all this expression here, you obtain this red one. Okay, so let's try to see where it's coming from. So again, the derivative of L with respect to W is first the derivative of L with respect to Y. Okay, so this is 2 times Y minus Y star when you are derivating this with respect to Y. Times, the next term is the derivative of Y with respect to V. You can find it here, it's Y. So this Y is a partial derivative of y with respect to v times the derivative of v with respect to u, which is 1, times the derivative of u with respect to w, which is x here. So you have the first component, the derivative of l with respect to y, times the derivative of y with respect to v, times the derivative of v with respect to u, times the derivative of u with respect to x. To w, sorry, which is x. By applying exactly the same formalism for the derivative of L with respect to B, you end up with this formula. So here I did by hand an explicit computation of what is called the gradient of the loss with respect to its parameter w and b. So let's see if it's working, if the mass is right. So here I'm computing the y of t. The first line is exactly the torch version of this expression, 2 times yt minus y star times y times x. Okay. And the second line is exactly this red line. And you see that the numbers agree. I'm obtaining 81 something and 162 for the gradient with respect to b, which is exactly what is given by this formula. So this is exactly what PyTorch is doing for us. This computation, which is done by hand, is made automatically by PyTorch. Now, one important thing is that if I'm computing this function a second time and doing a backward a second time, you will see that actually the gradient will increase. Okay. So I'm not obtaining the same result as here. I'm actually twice this result because the gradient are accumulated in the sense that they are summed each time you are making a backward. So it makes sense to do this in a deep learning setting because if you have two different functions on the same parameter, what you'd like to do is to update the parameter with the gradient, the sum of the gradient of the two functions. And this is exactly what is done here. So for example, if you have several batches, you want to add the gradient over the different batches. And this is done by default by PyTorch. But you need to remember this. Something else you need to remember is that you cannot backward a second time through a function that you did once. So the reason for this is very simple. It's when PyTorch is computing the gradient, it will compute a lot of intermediate results which are required for the finite gradient. And these intermediate results are erased when the computation is done. So if you are asking to do a second time a backward pass, so computing the gradient, this intermediate piece of information are missing and PyTorch is not able to do the gradient a second time. So if you know you want to do backward twice on the same function, you need to tell PyTorch that it must retain the graph. So this is what is written in the error code. And here is one example where I'm computing once LT and I'm doing a first backward where I'm saying retain graph equals true, so I can do a second one and I'm summing the gradient in my WT grad and BT grad here. Another thing which is quite important here is you see that since I'm adding the gradient each time in this grad field, if you want to restart from fresh, you need to manually put this gradient to zero, and this is done on this line, where you see that there is an underscore at the end of zero, meaning that I'm modifying the value of W2E grad data, and I'm putting it to zero. So, okay, so far we saw tensors, how to use tensors with PyTorch. We see how PyTorch is doing automatic differentiation. Well, indeed, we don't understand right now how it's doing automatic differentiation. I will keep that for the very end of this lesson, and you will need to understand it quite deeply in order to do the practicals for this lesson. But right now, what I want to show you is how to use this automatic differentiation on a very simple example. So here is the example I want to show you. It's a very basic linear regression. So here is our model, where we have what we call observation, xt and yt over there, where xt is a two-dimensional vector, and yt is just a real number. And how yt is obtained from xt is through this equation. So you are taking twice the first component of x, subtracting three times the second component of x, and adding a bias of 1. This gives you the y of t. Let's say you are in a setting where you have only access to the xt and the yt, and you do not have access to the weight 2 minus 3 and the bias plus 1. And your task is to estimate this weight and bias from the observation. One way to do that is to solve this optimization problem. So again, this is a fake problem, but let's see how this algorithm is working. So you have, let's say, 30 samples, and you want to find the best W1, W2, and B in order to minimize this quantity, which is the sum of all your sample of the difference between your estimation of the y and the true value taken to the square. Okay. So this is a minimization problem in the W1, W2, and B parameters. So you have three parameters to optimize in order to minimize this loss. Okay, so we'll present an algorithm solving this problem. At this point, we don't really care whether this algorithm is efficient, even working properly. We will only try to implement it first with basic NumPy function, and then see how this algorithm is simpler to implement with PyTorch. So let's start with the NumPy version. So I'm creating some random number for the x. I'm generating the what I'm calling here the labels, so the true value of y. So here are the first five samples for x. A small picture might be helpful. So what's another geometric way of seeing what we are doing? The x1 and x2 are these two axes, x1 here and x2 here, and the y is the vertical axis. The point here correspond to the observation, and you see that this equation is nothing else than the equation of this plan in this 3D space. So your task is from the blue point here, try to find the equation of the plan, where all these points are on the plane. And you want to minimize the mean square error. Okay, so here is a small description of the algorithm we will follow. So I'm rewriting my model in a vector form. So now W and B are the current estimate for the weight W on my bias B. What I will do is I try to minimize the loss, which is the sum over all my sample of the prediction y hat of t made by my model here with the current estimate of W and B compared to the true value. So this is the sum over all the sample of the difference taken to the square. So if this quantity is called loss of t, what I want to do is compute the derivative of this loss with respect to the parameter W and B. So I have a quadratic function. So this is a linear function in W and B. So y hat is linear. It's very easy to compute derivative of linear. And this is a quadratic function. So it's also easy to compute the derivative with respect to this quadratic function. And indeed, the explicit partial derivative are given here. So the partial derivative of loss of t with respect to W1 is 2 times the first component of x, x1, times the predicted value, the difference between the predicted value y hat of t and y. So it's given here. The second value is twice the second component of x times y hat minus yt. And the last one for the bias is just 2 times the difference. Okay, so these are the partial derivative of each component here. What I'm interested in is the gradient of the full loss. So I'm summing all the partial derivative in order to get the what is called the gradient of the loss with respect to the parameter W1, W2, and B. So here it's just a mathematical computation. And now the algorithm, which is called gradient descent or batch gradient descent, is the following. You will modify your current estimate of W1, W2, and B according to this rule. So you are following the gradient given here with a step size which is given by this alpha, and alpha is called the learning rate. So since you want to minimize the loss, you are going in the opposite direction of the gradient, and the new value for W1 will be the old value minus alpha times the partial derivative of the loss with respect to W1, and the same thing for the other parameter. So this is one update of the weight corresponding to what we call one epoch, and you will do several epochs in order to get better and better result for the weight W1, W2, and B. Okay. Let's see how this algorithm is coded in PyTorch, in NumPy, sorry. So we start with random guesses, initial random guesses for the weight W on the bias B. And now I'm defining basically 3 main functions. The first one is called forward. So the forward function is simply this function. So I'm computing the prediction y hat of t from the input x given my current estimate W on B. So this is x times W plus B. Very simple. Now I'm computing the loss for a given input x on the ground truth y. For this, I need first to do a forward pass here, and then I'm taking the difference to the square. So this is my loss function. The last thing I need to compute are these derivatives here, so the gradient. And it's done in vector form here. So given a current x and y, here are the derivative of the loss with respect to W. This is this first term here. And this is the derivative of the loss with respect to the bias here. So this expression corresponds exactly to this one, and the first one to in matrix form to this one. Three functions. And now is the training loop. So I'm defining a learning rate, my parameter alpha before. I will run my algorithm for 10 epochs, meaning that I will do 10 passes on my dataset. So the first thing I'm doing, I'm just taking gradient equal to zero. I'm doing one pass through my whole dataset here in this for loop inside one epoch. And you see that I'm accumulating the gradient for W and B by adding the previous value plus the new gradient computed here. Here the loss also is updated. And then I'm updating my weight W by following the gradient, opposite direction of the gradient, with the step size which is given by the learning rate. So let's see how it goes. So you see that the loss here is decreasing, which is good. And after 10 epochs, this is the estimate for my W and B. So you see it's not very good. Remember that the original value where W is equal to 2 minus 3 and the bias is 1. So we are still quite far from this value. If you want to get better result, you can probably go for more epochs. Okay, so you see that the loss is still decreasing and the estimate of your parameter, it's much closer from 2 minus 3 and 1. Okay, let's... For this lesson, I really don't care about precision, so I will just run everything for 10 epochs so that I have an approximate equation for my plan in three dimensions. The only thing I want to do is now to code this this algorithm, which is in NumPy, into an algorithm in PyTorch. So the first thing I will do is I will translate everything from NumPy to Tensor. So I'm using float Tensor. I don't need to run on GPU for this, but if you want, you can. And the first thing I need to do is transform my input and the true value in tensors. This is what is done here. The second thing I want to do is to take exactly the same initial guess for my W on my B, because I want to be sure that my algorithm is doing exactly the same thing as is in the NumPy version. So this is what I'm doing here. So now each time there is an underscore T, this means I'm dealing with tensor instead of NumPy array. So the initial value are the same. Now I'm modifying my code in order to define the three different functions I just defined in NumPy. So the first one is very easy, it's a forward with underscore T because I'm dealing now with tensor. And you see that the only modification is that I'm not using a dot, but a matrix multiplication in PyTorch, which is MM. Okay. The second function I need to define is the loss. Okay. Here I'm dealing with tensor, so this is why I'm putting underscore T. And the first thing I'm doing is computing the prediction made on my current input X, and then I'm comparing this with the true value Y, taking power 2 and summing. So this is the sum of the square in PyTorch. The last function I need to do is compute the gradient. So again, you have two quantities, the first one here, comma the second one here. The first one corresponds to the derivative of the loss with respect to the weight, and it's written in matrix form here. And the second one is the derivative of the loss with respect to the bias. So here I just modify the NumPy version to a Torch version, but I'm not using any fancy feature of PyTorch. I'm taking the same learning rate and going for 10 epochs. So here I'm simplifying a little bit also the code, because you see that inside an epoch there is no more for loop. So what I'm doing here is I'm computing directly the gradient on the wall for all my samples. So this x of t and y of t are now vectors, and this will give me the sum of the gradient for all the data set. So grad w is exactly what I would obtain after this for loop. And now I'm updating wt and bt with the learning rate times the gradient. And you see that the number should be exactly the same here as before in NumPy. So here, okay, they agree completely. So this is a simple translation in PyTorch of my basic NumPy algorithm. The first thing I want to do is use the PyTorch feature allowing me to do automatic differentiation. So here I did code the gradient by hand here because I did the math at the very beginning here. But I know that PyTorch is able to do this math for me for free. So this is exactly what I will do next. In order to tell PyTorch that I want to compute partial derivative, remember, I need to modify a little bit the tensor corresponding to my weight and bias. The tensor I want to take the derivative with respect to, by setting the requires grad field to true. So this is exactly what I'm doing here. I'm not modifying the value, but I'm telling PyTorch, okay, in what follows, you should be able to compute the gradient with respect to this parameter and to this one. Now here is an implementation of the gradient descent. So I'm still simplifying a little bit the code. I removed the explicit function for the forward on the loss, and it's directly inside my training loop. So here is the forward pass. It's just matrix multiplication plus bias. Here is the computation of the loss, okay, taking the difference between the prediction and the true value, taking it to the power 2 and summing everything. So now I told PyTorch that I want to take derivative with respect to this parameter and this parameter. So the only thing I need to do is the loss backward. I want to take the derivative of the loss with respect to W and the derivative of the loss with respect to B. Once I've done that, I can retrieve the gradient for each of my parameters and update them in this very simple way. Now, don't forget at the end of the epoch to put all the gradient to zero. So this is done here. Otherwise, you will add the gradient from epochs 1 to epochs 2 and so on, which is not the algorithm you want to run. So let's see how it goes. And you see that again, we obtain exactly the same number as here, because this algorithm is doing exactly the same thing as what we hard-coded here with the explicit formula for the gradient. Okay, so now we can still use PyTorch a little bit more in this specific case. Let's go back to the original setting. So this is my model. So I know I'm looking, so this is a linear model. If I'm giving you input x of t, the y is a linear function of x. If you want, this is just a matrix multiplication plus adding a bias. Okay. So this, in a deep learning setting, corresponds exactly to applying a linear layer on the input x. So what we will do now is we will construct a model which is a very simple neural network, taking as input x and doing the matrix multiplication and adding the bias thanks to the linear layer we saw last time. So let's do this. Okay, it's done over here. So I'm using the NN package. And in this NN package, this NN sequential that we already used last time and in the practicals for lesson one. We will come back to it later in the course. And this is the simplest model you can think of. It's a linear layer. The linear layer means that you are just multiplying by a matrix and adding a bias. What is the size of your input? It's 2, the x. And the output is 1, it's the y in our case. So you don't need to look at this. That's because I want to take for my initial matrix in my model exactly the same weight as the w init and b init in my NumPy to get the same number as before. So this is what is done here. Now, another modification I'm doing is it turns out that the loss I'm defining is already defined in PyTorch. It's called mean squared error, okay? And I'm not really taking the mean of the squared error, I'm taking the sum of the squared error, so this is why I'm adding this parameter here, reduction equals sums. And now here is the code for my training of my model now, for 10 epochs again. The first thing is the forward pass. So now I did define my model, so the prediction is just passing my input through my model. Computing the loss with the prediction on the YT. I'm putting manually all the gradient to zero in my model. I'm doing a loss backward here. And here is the magic. How does PyTorch know what are the parameters you need to take the derivative with respect to? Well, by default, when you are defining a model like this, the parameters are the parameters of the model. So when you are using a TorchNN package, by default, when you are defining your model, PyTorch assumes that all the parameters in your model will have a required grad equal to true. So you don't need to specify it manually. So this is why when you are doing the loss backward here, PyTorch is computing the derivative with respect to the parameter of your model. Now, if you want to update your parameter, you can do it manually here. So you need to retrieve your parameter in the model parameter and update the corresponding value of your parameter with the learning rate we specified. So let's see how it goes. And again, I'm running it for 10 epochs, and you see that I'm obtaining exactly the same value as before. Over there. And the reason is I started from the same initial point, and then I'm applying exactly the same algorithm, but in a much simpler way with PyTorch. Indeed, here, the main gain is that we do not have to compute explicitly the gradient anymore. It's done for you by PyTorch. There is one step which is still a bit annoying, which is this one. Updating all the parameters with the given learning rate. It turns out that it's very easy to do this in PyTorch by using the Optim package. So what the last modification I'm doing here is I want to get rid of this update of the parameter by using the PyTorch API. And for this, I'm telling PyTorch that I want to use SGD algorithm. So this is exactly the algorithm I described to you. And it's written here. So I'm defining an optimizer, which is SGD. I'm telling the optimizer which parameters I will need to update and what with which learning rate. So this will take care of this feature. So now PyTorch, when I'm defining my model, knows that the parameter I will update are the parameter inside this matrix plus the bias. And by using this line, PyTorch will know how I want to update this parameter. And now the code is very simple. It's just for, you can see everything in this cell. One training epoch, we run the training for 10 epochs. First, the forward pass by computing the prediction made on the current input, computing the loss. I'm putting all the gradient to zero to be sure that I'm not adding gradient to gradient of the previous epoch, doing a loss backward, computing the gradient. So I have all the gradient with respect to the parameter of my model, and then doing an optimizer step, which is exactly the same as updating the parameter in my model according to this algorithm because I'm using SGD, stochastic gradient descent, with the right learning rate. And you see that here you are obtaining exactly the same value as in the first NumPy version, but in just a few lines of code. So this piece of code for the training corresponds exactly to what you will do when you are training an algorithm with this red arrow over there. And you can go back to the code of lesson one and see that in the training epoch, you will see this piece of code in the training, in the function defining the training of your VGG model. One last remark is that this example is done mainly for pedagogical reasons, because if you, the only thing you really care is result, this problem of least square, so linear regression, is already encoded in Torch, so you can use this function, and you will see that the solution is given to you. Remember that the rate were 2 minus 3 and the bias 1, so you end up with exactly the right solution in just 3 lines of code. But again, the main purpose of this is to go from the NumPy version of gradient descent to the PyTorch version of gradient descent using the Torch NN linear model, the optimizer, and the backward function doing the automatic differentiation. We are almost done with this lesson. I will end up it with a bit more technical part. So what we saw is tensors, how to use tensors in PyTorch, how PyTorch is doing automatic differentiation. Well, actually we didn't see how it makes automatic differentiation, but we saw how to use automatic differentiation from PyTorch. And in the practicals of this lesson, you will need to understand how actually PyTorch is doing this automatic differentiation. So again, I will explain it on the example we just saw in the Jupyter notebook on these few slides, and you will need to code a NumPy version of automatic differentiation based on this example. So this is again the example where I'm computing this weird exponent of wx plus b and comparing it to the true value here and taking the square. And it's not completely clear in the Jupyter notebook why I did separate this complex function into several basic function on building what is called the computational graphs, and it should be clearer in a moment. So what PyTorch is doing is able to compute derivative of what is on the right here, the loss, with respect to the parameter W and B. So here is how things are done in PyTorch, mainly using the chain rule. So what you have access to are the partial derivative of each of these very simple functions with respect to its parameter and input. So for example, if you look at the first component here, which is just the multiplication, when you have input x and parameter w, the output here will be the multiplication of x and w. Then you know that the partial derivative of this with respect to w, which is what you want to compute in order to apply the chain rule, is simply x. For this second block, this is just the sum of the parameter b and the input u, obtaining v equals u plus b. You know that the derivatives are just 1. Then this last step is taking the exponent of the input v in order to get the y, and you see that the derivative of the output with respect to the input is just y itself. So now the chain rule is applied in this way. You want to compute the derivative of L with respect to W, but W does not appear in the simple expression. You know that W is hidden in this y here. So what you do is you take the derivative of L with respect to y and then multiply it with the derivative of y with respect to W. But again, if you look at y here, W is not here. Is it not inside this expression? You know that it's hidden in this v. So you will apply again the chain rule for y, and again on v, and again on u, in order to obtain this formula, where the partial derivative of y with respect to w is just the product of the partial derivative of y with respect to v times the partial derivative of v with respect to u, and the partial derivative of u with respect to w. In the end, when you do the math, you obtain this red formula. The first term here corresponds to the partial derivative of L with respect to y. Then you multiply by the partial derivative of y with respect to v, which is equal to y, the partial derivative of v with respect to u, which is equal to 1, and the partial derivative of u with respect to w, which is equal to x. So this is what mathematics tells you how to compute easily the partial derivative of L with respect to w. And you can apply the same rules for the partial derivative of L with respect to the bias B. But now, how to implement it on your computer? And this is depicted with this red arrow here by what people call the backward pass. So remember, the black arrows correspond to the forward pass, where given the input on the current estimate of your parameter, you are computing the loss. The backward pass is doing similar computation, but backward in time. So now, instead of looking at input and output, you look at incoming gradient and outgoing gradient. So now your task, if you want to define this block, is to understand, if I have an incoming gradient here, what should be the gradient that I should propagate to further in the computation graph. So let's go back to the example. So where is this gradient coming from? This is simply the gradient of L with respect to Y. Okay, so the first computation here in the chain rule. So it's 2 times Y minus Y star. So this is the incoming gradient coming into this block. Now on this block, I want to apply the chain rule. So I want to multiply this gradient with the gradient corresponding to this block. So what is this? Well, remember, it's written here. The forward path is taking the exponent. If you are taking the partial derivative of y with respect to v, it's just y itself. So if I have an incoming gradient of 2 times y minus y star, what should go here, flow as a gradient, is y times this quantity. Now, this block, I will do the same thing. The forward path is just a plus, an addition. Now, if I have an incoming gradient coming here, what should be the gradient that I should propagate on each of the arrows of the computational graph? Well, again, it's very simple. I should multiply by the partial derivative of this function with respect to b if I want to go up, and with respect to the input if I want to go horizontally. So in both cases, this is just multiplying by 1. So this is what is depicted by this red multiplication by 1. So if I have an incoming gradient v prime coming here, the gradient which is propagated here is just 1 times v prime. 1 times v prime, which is, in this case, 2 times y minus y star times y coming from here, which is exactly the derivative of y with respect to b. Last step, in the multiplication over here, if I have an incoming gradient coming here, I need to compute the gradient flowing towards the parameter w. So again, it's very simple. This is du, the partial derivative of u with respect to w, which is multiplication by x done here. So if I have an incoming gradient u prime here, the gradient which will reach this w is just u prime times x, which in this case is exactly the partial derivative of the loss with respect to w. So you see that here we did break the computation of the gradient, the partial derivative of L with respect to B, and the partial derivative of L with respect to W in minimal steps and independent steps done for each of these circle operations. So you have mainly three operations, taking the product, the sum, and the exponent. And for each of these operations, what you should define is the forward path, which is kind of trivial. For example, here, when I have an input v, I'm outputting exp of v here. But you also need to define the backward path, which is given any gradient I'm receiving from this side, what should be the propagation I need to propagate here. So in this case, I'm just taking this number and multiplying by y. This makes a block by itself here, and now each time you have a block which is defined with a forward and a backward path, you can plug them together in order to be able to compute, thanks to the chain rule, the gradient you are interested in. So this is exactly what is asked to be done for the practicals of the lesson 2, without using any PyTorch features. So we will deal with tensors and the nice feature of PyTorch in the subsequent practicals. But for now, just try to build from scratch a new multiplication operation, a new addition, and a new exponent, taking the exponent of something, where you both compute the forward path and the backward path in NumPy without any resorting to PyTorch. Okay, good luck for these practicals. I'll see you at the next course.